So today I will be talking about the WSO2 governance registry, particularly the version 4.6.0 and how it meets the SOA goals that you have in the enterprises. And I will be also talking about what is coming up in the next major release 5.0, and how it helps and scale your enterprise requirements. So today, initially, we'll be going through what is our governance registry and its architecture, and then we'll go through those features that helps on the SOA world. And so WSO2 platform. WSO2 platform, as you can see, it plays a major role here, where so give me a moment, okay. Okay, I hope now you can see me, see my screen. So let's look at the WSO2 platform. It has, as you can see, the whole WSO2 platform, where the service bus integrates all the subcomponents, and as you can see, the WSO2 governance registry also part of the integration platform. In fact, the enterprise service bus, and it loosely coupled with the rest of the WSO2 components, like WSO2 identity server, business activity monitor, complexity and processing server, likewise. And as you can see, in our whole platform, the SOA oriented whole platform, WSO2 governance registry plays a major role in this platform. So indirectly, WSO2 governance platform has been provided to facilitate some new products like API management and App Factory, likewise. So let's go through what is governance registry and what are the two main aspects of it. So in governance registry, the major aspect of it is repository and registry, as well as the governance framework. So in most cases, all the carbon servers that is released on the WSO2 platform has an embedded registry and a repository, which is kind of an embedded GREG. And also, it acts as a governance framework in addition to the repository aspect. So we'll talk about all these two aspects and how it helps you to cater your SOA requirements. So as you can see, governance registry can be act as a policy store for an identity server, or any service store for any application server, or any enterprise service bus, or some repository for the business rule server that we have, or maybe a repository to store artifacts for any gadget server, something like that. So, and also a WSO2 governance registry available as also available in the cloud as a governance as a service, as well as it's also available on premise. So if you look at the basic architecture of the WSO2 governance registry, it has a data access layer where it supports all major databases in the current enterprises. So For example, we support Oracle, MySQL, MSSQL, DB2, likewise. And on top of this one, this data layer, we have this registry repository layer, and it has these, all these extensions and the APIs that we have. And on top of that, we have these eventing, community features, searching capabilities, governance API, and on top of that, we have all these external interfaces where external third-party clients can create connections and interface with the repository. So in our architecture, we have a very simple lean model that, as you can see, we only have 17 table schemas. And you can compare it with some vendor like Jira, who has the issue tracking system, the well-known issue tracking system here, who has 90 plus tables. But what we have is only 17 tables, and we deal with them. So key features. So in so we are going through this set of key features, and we will be discussing on how these features will help you on building up a proper governance platform for your enterprise, and how it meets these SOA requirements. So we have something called RXT files, which is also known as registry extension files. We have the lifecycle features, repository and registry federation, collaboration between artifacts, searching capabilities, APIs, and many extension points that you that we can that anybody can use these extension points, and you can infinitely extend this product to meet your custom requirements. And also, we do have a tooling platform that you can create those artifacts on a separate tooling platform and archive those artifacts and then deploy them across your production servers. So let's look at what is RXT file. So artifacts detail. For example, this registry extension files, in the sense, this extension file formula, the schema provides you the ability to create your own digital assets and catalog them in the governance registry. So it gives you a nice view, and it gives you the ability to catalog your artifact attributes and their values in a proper manner and govern them. So it has a storage path, and it has some listing user interfaces that are also configurable. For example, you can define, okay, what is my artifact details? What is the media type of it? For example, if it is a WSDL file, what we have is a WSDL specific media type, and it a UI table for that, and we can configure a icon for that. So once those are done, you can define a storage path in the repository to which this particular set of instances of this catalog should get stored. And the listing user interface, in the sense, when you create, keep on adding artifacts, like you keep on adding WSDLs and services to this catalog. And but the listing view is like you can list all this stuff in a separate view, and that also configurable, where you can define, okay, for my this for my WSDL list view, okay, only these three particular columns should be visible, something like that. And also you can provide hyperlinks for the values of these stuff, and let them navigate to the directly through this to these resources. So this RXT file, in fact, you can think of as the carbon copy or of a service or a visual where you can provide the details of it and you can keep on creating instance out of it. So in Java world, RST files is something like a class and you keep on creating services like instances in the Java world. So also, you can define relationship in between these artifacts. And everything is has an artifact layout, like you can group them by table. Like, okay, for my overview table, in a service, it should have these my name of the service, namespace, and my service version only. And there can be another layout like my service content, and it has the service content itself. And it can have another layout called endpoints or documentation, and it, those stuff also can be configurable. So this provides you the ability to create your own service catalog. So this is a sample XML configuration snip of the RXT file that we have for services. You can define the particular RXT file by giving a media type and a short name. And for example, you can define what is the singular label of your artifact and what is the plural label, for example, plural label. If it is visual, the singular is WSDL and the plural is WSDLS, so something like that. And as you can see, you can define the UI elements, what is the list view that it should have, and all these columns you can configure. It is very easy. If you take about the other vendor, well-known vendors of the registry providers on maybe WebSphere, maybe Oracle, you might feel that if you have been through those configuring those stuff, you know how much time it takes to create some artifact catalog out of these one products. But in WSO2 governance registry, it is just a matter of minutes or seconds to create a service catalog and keep on creating artifacts in the production. So, and let's go to the life cycles. So every resource, every artifact can be bound to a life cycle. So typically, service can start off as a created state, and it can be ended up as in the runtime as an API, for example. So if we take a typical example, we create a service out of gathering the requirements and maybe with the contract first, we might have the service documentation, and we keep on developing it and make it an API eventually. So if it for a service, the life cycle stage can be like created, the development state, testing state, staging, production, and then okay, now I'm an API in production, something like that. So life cycle, as you can see in the screenshot, you can provide the name for the life cycle, and it has its own state, and you can provide some validations, some policies between the transitions from the state. So for example, if you want to go from design state to the development state, you need to enforce some static policies. Okay, these set of checklist items should be fulfilled before it goes to the development state. For example, code should be complete, quality of service should be created, then visual schema should be created before it goes to the development state. So something like that. And that is one way of providing these static policies for the life cycle. And in the life cycle management, I will be talking more about how much this is extensible to provide you various custom requirements around these lifecycle management, because if we talk about the governance, everything is about lifecycle management mostly. So, as I mentioned, WSO2 G-Rich governance registry has an extensible architecture to support the lifecycle management. So, and we do provide a default lifecycle management, which is yet again pluggable, which has these all these extensions that I will be talking. Like, for example, users can develop their own lifecycle through a simple configuration. So, you can define custom states. So it need not to be the state that we define, but a custom set of states for your lifecycle, and custom set of checklist items that can be defined and enforce a particular lifecycle state transition. And also we provide scripting, like we provide some client side scripting, JavaScripting, in between these lifecycle state transitions. So when you create an asset, you can you are given a front end interface to add a lifecycle, and you can deal with it. So the lifecycle configuration is based on OSIS CXML, and it is a very simple XML configuration language, and you can define each state, and you can define multiple states for a lifecycle, and in each lifecycle you can individually define what is the data model that it needs to adhere. Like for example, the data model name, the check items referred to the check items that we have already saw in the previous slide, that you can tick on the set of check items and you can proceed on to the next state. So something like that. And we also provide several such data models, like some custom well data. So you can intercept a piece of Java code, for example, during an state transition. That's what we call transition validation, which is again a data model. And executors in the sense, yet again, some interceptor that can be configured to get hit in between a lifecycle transition. And there is a concept called the transition UIs, which means between transition you can pop up, give a pop-up UI, and that is also a very useful extension point in terms of lifecycle management. So developing custom behaviors is like how we provide these through the aspect. Aspect is a term in GRH where aspect is one of the three extension points where we provide flexibility, a pluggable approach, where all these rules and policies can be enforced. So a lifecycle itself is a particular aspect. So federation in the sense, if you talk about a set of carbon clusters, if you are already using a set of WSO2 products, for example, you need to federate your repository, your artifact. So for example, if you have an ESB production deployment, let's say it is a 5-node ESB cluster. So you need to, and all these 5-node in the ESB cluster, it has similar configuration. So why you need to duplicate all these configurations in each and every server? So, suppose if you want to do an upgrade on the fly for the ESB, so now what happens? So if you are in production and you need to do some slight change, you cannot. You can't be, in fact, touching all these servers, so it is not scalable. So what you can do is you can federate your configuration space of your enterprise service bus across the cluster by a governance registry. So which means that you can so these carbon servers like enterprise service bus, API managers, any carbon server can act as can act in a hybrid model where you you share one portion of your embedded repository across the cluster while keeping another portion local to the node itself. So in that sense, a particular keep some space local to itself and share some space. So in the shared space, the shared space can be updated through a central governance registry, and it will be the central point that you add all this stuff, and everything will get reflected across the cluster on the fly without any server downtime. So so you can connect to the these you can do this achieve this the repository federation through the JDBC or Atom. And but currently we only recommend the JDBC model, and Atom has several drawbacks, and it basically due to its slowness by design. So we recommend the JDBC repository federation in GRED. And and as you can see, this federated deployment helps you to share your space across the cluster and connect your stuff and avoid duplication, and provides you a single entry place, one stop place where that you can govern all your enterprise artifacts in a single place. So it can be multiple servers that you can federate. So it can be a web application server, an enterprise server, and you can share the spaces with the GRED. And this is the hybrid, another type of hybrid model that within the cluster it has its own federated deployment, and you have another similar cluster where it also has another in-house federated repository with another GRED, and altogether the two clusters yet again federated against another master GRED. So there are some such well-known deployment patterns that you can achieve based on your requirement. So the repository effect. So in the repository, we allow you to store artifacts in the repository where it has, the repository is a basic tree structure that it has, which has all these repository features that we provide with the GRED. For example, you can out of the box keep on adding digital schemas, policies, APIs, models, model files, in fact, and documentation files, etc. And you can install any type of such files, artifacts, anything on the repository, and eventually they will get stored as an XML content inside, and you need not to worry about that. So the collection and resources. This is the building blocks of the repository. So collections corresponding to a folder in the in a file system, and a resources, and a resource is correspond to a file in the file in a file system. So collection is like a folder, and resource is like a file. So and this repository is scaled and designed to accommodate any amount of resource. So in that context, we have several ways of achieving the performance, like we have several caching layers, for example, and media types. So media type is a term that identifies a particular artifact. So media type, for example, in a whistle, the media type is something different. And if it is a video file, if it is a image, the media type is different. And by the way, you can define your own media type and save your artifacts. And properties, like properties are key value pairs, and you can, for any resource, you can have multiple properties with key value pairs, and you can easily access those stuff. And the next thing is associations. So association is, you can have the association by defining a source source and a target resource, and you can define your own association type and create a association link in between these two artifacts. So the advantage is that even from the user interfaces, even from the APIs, so once you associated it, if you go to a particular artifact, it will show you the details, the information of the of its own artifacts that are depends on itself. So a resource can have associations to another resource, as I mentioned, and so associations can be made with a web URL or a resource path. So which I meant is you can use a registry path or a web service URL for the target path. And symbolic link. Symbolic link is a link to an existing resource, like it is more like a file shortcut in Windows. So you can create a symbolic link for a particular resource that you might think that it can be useful. And it can be frequently using a collection or a resource, or maybe you can pick several WSDL files and create symbolic links to those stuff and make them available in an easily reachable place in the repository. So remote links. Remote links in the sense, a resource in a remote registry can be mounted as a resource in the current registry. So so in that context, we define a mounted resource as a remote link. So you have, this is the similar situation, the story that we are talking about, federating artifacts across any carbon server with a GRID. So this remote, the remote instance is the ESB, for example, in our case, and GRID is the central governance registry. And we create a remote link from ESB to GRID, and the current ESB resource is actually a remote resource, but it is acting as a local resource for the ESB. So which is basically the typical mounting concept that you find in Windows. So the other one is versioning, that which is another feature that we are providing on top of the repository, that when you do some stuff for a repository, the versioning aspect is a must. So you need to, when you keep on changing your services, systems, etc., at some point of time, you might think, okay, hold on a sec, what have I done? So I want to revert my stuff back to yesterday. So what you can do is you can keep on creating checkpoints from your day-to-day activities, and you can revert them back to your checkpoints. So and also it is configurable that what needs to be versioned. So if it is a resource, you can the properties can be versioned, the comments, the tags, the ratings of the resource can be versioned, and you can enable and disable these the versioning, because we provide this capability, because if it is a highly interactable environment, we normally does not recommend to turn on versioning, because it has a performance hit, as you know. For each and every single operation that you do to the repository, we create snapshots out of them. So, and it is keep on going, and it affects for the performance. So by default, out of the box, from GRID 4.6.0 onwards, the versioning is disabled. produce that reason. So creating checkpoints. So as I mentioned, you can create a checkpoint and make it pinpoint, and you can reuse that checkpoint later to revert your stuff back. So in terms of the permission model, so a particular resource or a collection can have set of permissions like read, write, delete, and authorize. So we have a role-based permission model that we can grant this set of permissions to your LDAP role, to your user store roles, and users who are logged in on those particular roles are getting get corresponding grant types for the defined collections and resources. So for example, if you are creating this tool and you are storing it in the repository, and suppose you want you don't want the developers to see production visuals. So production ready visuals can only be viewed, or at least for example, let's say the write access to the production visuals, or maybe staging visuals, can only be allowed for the architect or maybe the DevOps folks, but not the developer. So you can restrict those stuff with the role-based permission model. And also, permissions are inherited. So allow has more priority than deny. And the inheritance of the permission is very useful, that you can define a permission in one particular a collection, and the permission will get propagated down the line on the entire subtree. So retention is another feature that we have, like it provides the retention capability for a particular resource. So you can add the retention policy, like okay, I'm creating a retention for this particular resource from today to next Wednesday. So from today to next Wednesday, nobody can write to this resource, something like that. So collaboration, for any repository, you need this collaboration where people can view these resources and they can comment on these stuff, they can rate the resource, they can tag these resource, and tag can be very useful in terms of searching. So if you, suppose you are a web app giving a Picasa or Flickr like application, and you need to store all your images and make them govern them in a proper manner. So the best place that you can use governance registry as the repository for your images. And then out of the box, we provide these all these community features around a resource, like commenting, ratings, tagging, searching, and atom feeds likewise. So comments, tags, rating, searching. Searching is another very critical aspect of GREG, that searching is very useful and it should be very fast, in fact. So we are providing a tag search, which is again a very useful one. So you can tag these resources from you can have your own tag cloud, and you can tag this stuff and you can keep on searching out of these tags. And other than this tag search, we have an advanced search where you can define the resource name, created date, from the updater based on the tags, comments, maybe the properties, property name or property value, and etc. So advanced search is something that you can provide so many details of the resource, and you can keep on searching. Content search, we use Apache Lucene and Apache Solr for content search. So for searching, we provide indexing layer that enhance the searching latency, and it will give you a very very user friendly experience, that even though you have hundreds and thousands of visitors or services or any artifacts, the searching is very fast because we do index them. And if you add a visitor on the fly, they will not get reflected, but it will take a couple of seconds for those to get viewed, because the indexer running, and once the index the visitor or any artifacts, then only you can see the stuff on the UI. So indexing is another crucial part. And the activity search is another very useful feature, that everything that you do in the repository is logged, every activity. So okay, user foo has updated the resource with this particular content, user foo has deleted this particular resource, user foo has viewed this resource, user bar has do something else for this set of resource, something like that. So everything is get recorded and get logged. So, and all these activities can be searched from the activity search that we have, and it is a very useful feature. So this filtering is like for any governance artifact, we can provide advanced filter where you can you are given a particular artifact catalog, like searching advanced search filter, that you can fill these attributes and you can keep on searching to a similar type of services or any artifact. So in this case, the image shows about the filtering of services. Okay, so connect us to the external world. So GH, as I mentioned, has connectors inbuilt, like to connect to the external world. So it can be WSO2 products, it can be non-WSO2 products. So in terms of WSO2 products, we provide connecting to API manager, connecting to enterprise service bus, business activity monitor, CEP, those are the major four products that we have connectors. So connectors, in the sense, do not misunderstand this with ESB connectors, but this is a connector interfaces that we have provided to connect with the products, like the WSO2 products, like API manager, ESB, BAM, and CEP. So if I talk a bit more detail on these connectors, so WSO2 API manager, how WSO2 GREG can integrate to API manager. So out of the box, we support when a service is created from the GREG, and you create a service in GREG with a name and a namespace and with all these attributes, along with a service endpoint, and you keep on evolving this particular service from the development state to testing, staging, and then let's assume that you are in the production state. And when you're in production state, you are given the ability to publish the service as an API to an API manager within your network. So this particular feature, the connector does not need any database sharing between API manager or GREG. Everything is happened through WS interfaces, and you can publish your service that has been went through a proper development governance lifecycle, and eventually it will be get pushed to the API manager. So it will be available in the API publisher, publisher or the store. So in the out of the box scenario, the service will be created as an API on the API publisher. and enterprise service bus. So this is another very, very useful connector that if you take an enterprise service bus, there are so many artifacts that can be that can be governed from a governance layer. So for example, ESB proxy services, sequences, endpoints, and all these ESB artifacts can be monitored through governance registry. So monitoring in the sense, not the traffic. So for the traffic monitoring and all these stuff, you have the WSO2 business activity monitor that can be pluggable to any of these servers, and you can have an end-to-end business activity monitoring capability. But here, what I meant is a runtime governance aspect that you can achieve by integrating GRED to an enterprise service bus. So what this basically means is that you can simply plug GRED to ESB within 2 minutes, and you can start the servers, and ESB will keep on adding their proxy services, sequences, and endpoints. And what GRED does is it creates corresponding metadata catalogs for proxy services, endpoints, and sequences on the GRED side with all these metadata. And you can have an impact analysis view on GRED. For example, in the ESB itself, if you go to a particular sequence or an endpoint, or suppose a schema that has been used by the SSLD mediator, or a WSDL that is referred by a proxy. So if you go to this particular artifact, you might not know, and in fact, obviously, you do not know. If I change this particular sequence or endpoint or WSDL, who are the proxy services? What are the proxy services and sequences that will get affected? So that can such kind of impact analysis view can be seen from the GRED. And business activity monitoring CEP connectors are basically we provide out of the box some injectors from the GRED side where you can push your crucial critical registry operations metadata to an external business activity monitor or a CEP engine, a complex event processing engine. So we do have articles of this. If you go to the WSO2 governance registry 460 wiki docs, you can find these articles documentation. And WSO2 GRED will publish these all the actions that have been done to the repository to the external business activity monitor or the CEP server. And from that point onwards, you can write the CEP queries. Real-time event stream can be bridged to the CEP, and it can have runtime queries and do runtime governance with complex event processing server. And also you can plug the BAM and get reporting and monitoring and all this stuff. So if you talk about the non-WSO2 connectors, we have a connector for Oracle Service Bus, where Oracle Service Bus can use GRED as its repository to store its WSDLs and business services. So Alfresco OpenCMIS is yet another connector. So APIs and extension points. So in this section, we talk about the homegrown APIs that can be used. So as I mentioned, we are providing several web WS interfaces. WS interfaces, many interfaces that you can deal with as an external client. So registry web service API is something like that, which is a SOAP, basically SOAP one. And We have an Atom Pub API, and also we have the Registry Management API, which is again a SOAP service, which is also known as our Admin API. And also, Registry Host Object can be accessed. We provide a RESTful API for the repository, and also we provide governance API, and also a CRUD API for configurable governance artifacts. So this, in particular, this CRUD API for configurable governance artifacts, in the sense, if you create any type of custom artifact catalog in the registry, in the GREG, GREG inside create a dedicated RESTful CRUD API for your artifact, for your artifact type. So if it is a Vistel, I'm getting a Vistel CRUD API. If it is a service, I'm getting a service CRUD API, that you are given the flexibility to deal with your CRUD APIs create your own custom US and external connectors. So other than that, we have the JMX API, and also we do have the Apache Maven SCM connector feature, where you can plug your SCM external repository to a GREG repository location, and you can dump the stuff again from the registry and put it back to the, for example, the DSVN. So the other major point is that the extension points that we provide. So this is a very useful feature that we have. Like this is the place where most of our customers get attracted, because these extension points are very useful and very handy and easy to use. And this is the entry point that you can customize this WSO2 GREG product to your enterprise governance platform. So we provide handlers, filters, the aspects, custom user interfaces, HCM connectors, query processors. So if you talk about the handlers, like when a resource gets stored to the repository, and before it gets stored, you can intercept handlers and you can do some custom stuff on behalf before it gets stored. For example, when you are creating a service or a Vistel, when you are storing a Vistel in the GREG, GREG itself extract this Vistel, validate it, and then create a service out of it, out of the box, and or create endpoints and schemas also out of the box. So that is done from a handler. So that is a very good example that we use in-house to utilize handlers. Filters is the one that filters what are the type of artifacts that should get hit for a particular handler type. And custom user interfaces you can always have as a general carbon platform-wide extension point that you can write your own custom UI bundle and deploy them on our environment. Query processor is like you can create your custom query processors and plug, and we can also have custom reports, schedule tasks. You can run your own scheduled task and achieve your custom requirements. And also we do have an stat collector that is also useful to collect statistics. So extension points in terms of governance is like if you talk about the lifecycle operations, we do have the validators, executors, user interfaces, scripts that is getting intercept in between a lifecycle transition, and also we have the custom notification model where you can subscribe to any event type in GREG, like an artifact update, artifact delete, artifact lifecycle transition, something like that. And you can subscribe to it in many ways, like you can subscribe to it to by providing a set of email or a particular email, or you can provide a REST or a SOAP endpoint as a subscription. And there are several others as well. So the extensibility to the handlers, specs, remote APIs, and custom UIs. So in terms of tooling, WSO2 Developer Studio always provides tooling for the Carbon platform and also for the GRID. You can create those aforementioned artifact catalogs through Developer Studio. So other features like reporting, scheduling, subscription, and notification in particular we have. And let's talk about the building a connected business with WSO2 Governance Registry. So as Kushlani mentioned initially, so WSO2 Governance Platform and its extensibility helps you to build your own connected business. So as I mentioned, if you follow carefully the features that I have specified in the WSO2 GRED current version, those are very useful to build and connect your business where you have an integrated, accessible, a collaborative, and a adaptive platform for your enterprise. So now it is time for questions. If you have any questions, I will be happy to answer any questions.
Very much, Subhash. So that opens up the Q&A for the session. If you have any questions, you can send them in now. I'm just going to allow you a couple of minutes to send in your questions. Right, since I don't see any questions coming in and since we've run over time slightly, we will be closing up the session now. However, if there are any questions that you would like clarified by Subhash, you can email them to webinars@wso2.com. I'm just going to send you the email address on chat and we'll be more than happy to answer your questions via mail. And the slides and recording of this session, of course, will be recorded and made available to you over the next couple of days. And you will receive a follow-up email that will give you the link to the slides and recording. All right, with that, we conclude today's webinar session. I'm sure that you walked away with a very good understanding of the WSO2 Governance Registry product and why it should be part of your SOA infrastructure. If you want further information, you can, of course, download the product and try it out and see for yourself the benefits that it can bring your business. And if you're currently evaluating it and you want more help or you want any support, you can still get in touch with us. There's a contact us form that you can fill on the website or you can simply email us on bizdev@wso2.com. With that, we wrap up today's session. Thank you very much for attending and a big thank you to Subhash for presenting. He's been presenting quite a lot of webinars this month. I think there are quite a few more lined up for him. We do hope to see you at future webinars as well. Thanks very much. Have a good day. Right, since I don't see any questions coming in and since we've run over time slightly, we will be closing up the session now. However, if there are any questions that you would like clarified by Subhash, you can email them to webinars@wso2.com. I'm just going to send you the email address on chat and we'll be more than happy to answer your questions via mail. And the slides and recording of this session, of course, will be recorded and made available to you over the next couple of days. And you will receive a follow-up email that will give you the link to the slides and recording. All right, with that, we conclude today's webinar session. I'm sure that you walked away with a very good understanding of the WSO2 Governance Registry product and why it should be part of your SOA infrastructure. If you want further information, you can of course download the product and try it out and see for yourself the benefits that it can bring your business. And if you're currently evaluating it and you want more help or you want any support, you can still get in touch with us. There's a contact us form that you can fill on the website, or you can simply email us on bizdev@wso2.com. With that, we wrap up today's session. Thank you very much for attending, and a big thank you to Subhash for presenting. He's been presenting quite a lot of webinars this month. I think there are quite a few more lined up for him. We do hope to see you at future webinars as well. Thanks very much. Have a good day. See for yourself the benefits that it can bring your business. And if you're currently evaluating it and you want more help or you want any support, you can still get in touch with us. There's a contact us form that you can fill on the website, or you can simply email us on bizdev@wso2.com. With that, we wrap up today's session. Thank you very much for attending, and a big thank you to Subhash for presenting. He's been presenting quite a lot of webinars this month. I think there are quite a few more lined up for him. We do hope to see you at future webinars as well. Thanks very much. Have a good day.